Good evening. We're very glad that you've all come tonight. I am looking around, seeing lots of, always when we have those, I see lots of new faces. I have such a bad memory, you may be here all the time and I've forgotten you, but I'm still encouraged that new people are coming, at least it appears to me. And we hope tonight is a very edifying night for you. And on the part of Evergreen Presbyterian Church, I'm an assistant pastor here, we welcome you all and hope you feel welcome tonight. Tonight, we have the topic of, can modern science disprove the soul? Should be very interesting. Before I dig in a little bit to the debate, I don't want to forget that Robert has DVDs. He asked me to let you know this. Of any of the previous debates that have happened here, you can purchase those for $5 each in the back with Robert. And tonight, we have two debaters that are, if you've been coming, you're familiar with. We have the pastor of Evergreen here, Nathan Lewis, representing the Christian perspective. Let's welcome Nathan. Okay, I'm calling it a debate, and that's what I think of, but it's more of a discussion with two different worldviews that you will hear tonight. Which is actually a debate, good point. And representing the secular humanist worldview, we have Bernie Dehler. Let's give Bernie a hand. Bernie works at Intel, and he is also the founder of West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group, and a similar group that meets in a different part of the city, Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group. And on the back of your folder, if you have it, you have information about how to be in touch with those organizations. And obviously, you're here in our church. You know how to get here. You're always welcome here. We have lots of information in the back, too, if you'd like to know more about our church or talk with Nathan and I. The format tonight, typical, what we've been doing, we'll give each speaker 10 minutes to present their perspective. Then I will possibly ask a couple of questions of each. If I come up with some good questions, I'd like further elaboration on. And then they will ask each other questions for 5 minutes each. And then the last part of the time, the largest chunk of the time, for about 45, 50 minutes, we'll have Q&A, and you all will have your opportunity to ask them questions. And I would simply encourage you on the question and answer time, if you really feel like you have some burning questions of either that aren't related to the topic, that's permitted. But we are working with the topic tonight. If you have a question about that, maybe that'd be the first thing to ask, to delve into that a little bit more, the topic at hand. And please try to avoid sermonettes on your questions. And I know this is a heated situation sometimes, and it's handled very nicely, but we do sense and feel and have convictions about truth, and they're not always the same. And unfortunately, there's after the time of Q&A, people stay around here for a long time, and they discuss things, and maybe even passionately. But during the Q&A time, please try to make your question as concise as possible, avoiding giving too much background or a sermonette of your views on that. Try to make it very precise. Okay? Good. Well, we've already discussed this amongst ourselves. Bernie will be starting us off tonight. So, Bernie, it's all yours.
All right. Thank you, guys. It's an honor to be here. This is a very interesting topic for me because it's one of the major reasons why I left Christianity. So I'll talk more about that. So we'll go to the first slide. My presentation tonight is, this is my overview. I'm going to talk about what is secular humanism. And I'm going to make these claims about the soul, that there's a lack of a definition, clear definition for what the soul even is. And then looking at nature and even the human life cycle, we can look at this topic called emergence, about we can see the different gradations of the mind. And I'm going to make a point that I think the soul is superfluous to the mind, which means it's just something extra added on there that's not needed, and I'll explain that. And I think the Bible also contains some obvious myths that I'm going to bring up. And so because of that, I think the Bible is not reliable to stake your beliefs on for things that we can't determine for ourselves, like the hope of an afterlife. And then finally, answering Alvin Plantinga's criticism of naturalism, there's a book that we brought along. Okay, so let me show my books here, too. That's this book right here, Where the Conflict Really Lies. Alvin Plantinga is a theologian, and he says, yes, there's a conflict with science and religion, but the conflict is with the religion of naturalism. So that's my comeback to explain why I disagree with him. Next slide. So this is my definition of secular humanism. Very crisp and clearly is that it's a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by using science and reason. And so the only thing that a Christian might really object to there is that I don't allow the supernatural into my thinking, because I equate that with superstition for the reason that I don't think there's any valid evidence for that. Next slide. So why I left Christianity? There's two reasons why I left Christianity. One big one was evolution. Basically, with biological evolution, we know there was no first human. And I want to mention a good book. Richard Dawkins wrote The Magic of Reality, and he has a section there explaining about why there's no such thing as a first human, biologically speaking. So if there's no first human, there's no initial paradise that was built up, no fall from sin, so there's no cosmic cause for sin, no cosmic savior needed for that. And then the second thing that I came to see was that the soul, and I thought, well, is there any way to disprove the idea of a soul or an afterlife? And at first I thought, well, I don't think so. But as I thought about it, I did come up with some ways that I think the soul could be disqualified. So let's go to the next slide. The science impact on the soul. For number one, theologians can't really define the soul very clearly. I have a master's in ministry degree, and there's some debate over the soul and the spirit. Are they synonymous? Are they different? How are they different? And sometimes they even confuse in there that the imago Dei, made in the image of God. What exactly does that mean? Theologians have different ideas. Well, it's because it's all kind of superstitious, made up. It's hard to, you can't measure it or anything, I would say. So then secondly, if the mind emerges from the brain and the soul is not really saying, there's no really job for it, so it's superfluous. As for example, if I said, when I lift this book up, there's 1,000 angels also lifting it up, because every action takes 1,000 angels to do something. Well, that would be an interesting hypothesis. And somebody else might say, yeah, but every action also has 1,000 demons opposing it, so you need actually an extra 1,000 angels to overcome that. So maybe it's 2,000 angels versus 1,000 demons. Well, you can come up with all these theories, but, there's no way to measure it or anything. So that's what I mean by it's superfluous. There's no reason to come up with this idea of a soul when we know how the brain works and it creates the mind is created from that. Then also consider this idea of emergence. When you look across all the different species, you can see the different kinds of nervous systems, and even like the Venus flytrap doesn't have a brain, but it's got some kind of a nervous system where it can detect movement and clamp down on an animal. And so as you see more and more animals more complex, they have more complex behavior. For example, animals show signs of love, loving their children or their kindred. They even show, I could say they show works of art. They've done some experiments where they taught monkeys actually how to gamble, and they see some effects about, how do they gamble, how do they use these tokens and stuff. And so the only thing that humans really do differently with their mind is somebody might say, well, we worship God. Well, that's because, I'll get to that. So number four, observe the emergence and also the dissipation of minds in the life cycle of a human. So, when a person starts out as the sperm meets the egg, that's just one cell, and that divides into 2, 4, 8, et cetera. But even at like 8 cells, there's no brain, there's no nerve cells even, there's nothing. So gradually, this brain develops, and from the brain, we get the mind. And this is how when you get older and smarter, and your personality is based on what you go through in life. And then if you live to an old age, you might actually go through this dissipation where you get Alzheimer's. Next slide. So biblical evidence against the resurrection. Well, I thought, if the Bible could be shown to have some myth, then maybe there's good reason not to believe this thing about having a soul. So here's three things. I bring up, I call this a zombie passage. Matthew 27, it says when Jesus died, the tombs opened up and these people wandered around. It's like, who are these people? They go back in the graves later? Did they have families? Did they die again? That's kind of weird because there wasn't supposed to be a resurrection where people came to life and then died again. So a lot of that doesn't make sense. And some Christians may say, well, hopefully that was added later. Maybe that's not really in the originals. But the problem is it's in the earliest copies, so it's hard to just say we can't really say that's in the original. The second one is in Acts. It talks about Jesus ascending into heaven. Well, back in those days, they thought heaven was up literally there. So when somebody goes into heaven there, they go into space. And now with the space program, we know heaven's not up there. The third thing is Mark 16. It talks about, you know, if a believer drinks poison, they won't be killed by it. Well, we know, I don't think any Christian believes if they drink poison, they're going to be saved by a miracle. But in that passage there, it's easy to find out that actually the originals don't have that, most likely. So that one there, it's easy to see that it was added afterwards, but then you might ask, well, how did something get added into the Bible? The Bible is God's word and perfect. Next slide. Why was the soul invented? I think because humans, we have this survival instinct, and we have a fear of death, and we knew it was going to happen, so we try to deal with it. The theist invented this afterlife theology. Some atheists think, well, you know, they're afraid of death too, so maybe someday we'll have technology where we can download our consciousness into it and live forever. They have hopes like that. But I think the best thing is to just come to acceptance of our place in nature. The next slide. Alvin Plantinga is this theologian I mentioned. He basically makes this argument that naturalism is a faulty belief system because, you know what, if naturalism is real, according to evolution, things just happen because they're survival of the fittest. Evolution doesn't happen to discern. The goal of evolution is not to discern truth. This is his argument. If you're a naturalist, it's just survival of the fittest. That's all there is. And so my rebuttal is evolution is a constant arms race. For example, there's a saying, like a poetic way, that the teeth and the claws of the cheetah have carved the speed and the grace of the gazelle, and vice versa. So for humans, you know, we developed technology for war, and that brought on the space age and nuclear technology. We need this leading edge science in order, basically, for war purposes. And as we create new science, that, you know, we have to be in the truth for that stuff to work. So I'm saying this is an easy rebuttal because, basically, for our need for survival, we have to be in the truth. And, you know, for example, if people believe in God. You know, can you imagine warfare where they say, yeah, we believe in God, we'll do hexes and all this stuff. Well, if that worked, the military would be doing hexes and things like that, but they don't do that. They develop new technology. Next slide. So just in summary, I'm going to go over this quickly, but I think it's we just need to determine, we need to follow the truth and not what feels good. And so we have to study science to understand the truth. Some people may think that's a downer to accept that we're mortal and we're going to one day die, but there's some positive sides to that too. For example, having a deeper appreciation for every living moment. You know, and some examples of people dealing with this temporariness is like these ice hotels and sandcastles. You know, they're very temporary pieces of art, but they last for a long time. This guy has a record of 37-foot sandcastle. It took like 1,500 volunteers to make it. So, next slide. So this is my closing slide. I'll just say in summary, this is what I'd like you to do. You know, this is my come to Jesus statement. Instead of come to Jesus, I would like you to make a devotion to come to the truth, wherever it leads. I did this as a Christian. I said, I'm going to follow the truth wherever it leads. And I thought, you know what? Some people thought that might be strange for a Christian to do that because it seems like God should be more important than the truth. But I figured Jesus said, you know, he's the way, the truth, the life. And if that's true, all the truth will come to him. And for me, it didn't work out that way. And so I would encourage you guys all to make a devotion to the truth because there's nothing to fear about that. And even put the devotion to the truth above God. And if God is true, there's nothing to worry about. So anyway, I'll leave it with that. Thanks.
Well, thanks, Bernie, for the Bible study. That's good. And the topic before us this evening, I don't know if you know this, but Bernie has been our moderator for the past few years. And this is the first time Bernie has presented. and Keith is moderating. And our topic this evening is, can modern science disprove the existence of the human soul? David Barash, an atheist and biologist at the University of Washington, was asked, what is the most difficult unsolved problem in science? And his response, without batting an eye, was how the brain generates awareness, thought, perceptions, emotions, what philosophers call the hard problem of consciousness. There are few scientists of any field today who are willing to reduce the human being to a mere physiological faculty. We refer to that faculty as the body, the flesh. To do so reduces the human being to machine. British physician James Lefanu, in his book, Why Us? How Science Rediscovered the Mystery of Ourselves, writes, while it is theoretically possible for neuroscientists to know everything there is to know about the physical structure and activity of the brain, its product, the mind, with its thoughts and ideas, impressions and emotions, will still remain unaccounted for. The rise and establishment of psychology as a credible and useful science has served the development of philosophy, both recognizing the immaterial yet real and useful existence of the faculties of the human mind, emotions, will, spirit. Psychology has integrated with sociology and anthropology to establish the existence of self and personality. Jen and all other sexy GPS personalities or robotic customer service reps online are borrowed projections of actual immaterial faculties we have encountered in real human beings. Yet we know scientifically that there is still a significant gap between an actual human being and Siri, Apple's personal assistant, who is an artificial personality born of lines of codes. Interestingly, though none of us have ever seen Siri's body, as it does not exist, we suspect strongly that Siri is a female, based on her voice and personality. Someone might reason, Siri's artificial personality proves that all immaterial faculties of a human being are projections, that is, the artificial presentation of the neurological system. The only material and thus authentic faculty of the human being, after all, is just the body, the neurology of us. But someone else might also reason quite soundly, our ability to create Siri's artificial personality and our apparent need to do so proves that the immaterial faculties of the human being actually exist and are significant and authentic. Without these immaterial faculties, a human being would not be human at all, but some version of a complex machine, a replicant. Those of us who are sci-fi fans know that the 1982 film Blade Runner is among the all-time best sci-fi films, Bernie, ever made.
I never saw it.
Well, you should see it. It's great. Yeah, it's really weird that I'm a sci-fi fan and Bernie isn't. So, the film actually is not a bad presentation, Bernie, of the difference between the human being and the machine. But let's be honest, if our views of the human being are based on such films as Blade Runner and sci-fi literature, which I love, then we have not engaged in serious source materials. The view that Bernie is presenting tonight is known in the world of science as reductionism, a term used in the amazing collaboration of the sciences of our day. Reductionism is held by those who are atheists first, allowing their atheism to inform their views of the sciences. Those scientists who put their science first are the most critical of reductionism in our world today. That is, they are highly critical of reducing the human being, reducing any of us to body. Plato, the great philosopher whose life work established the foundations for Western thought, believed that the human soul was indestructible, not to mention a distinct immaterial faculty. He was in no way a Christian. The majority of Christian thought has presented the human soul also as indestructible, an immaterial faculty distinct from the body. Indeed, Plato came to his conclusions through a different process than Christians who hold the same view. Alvin Plantinga, who is a Christian philosopher, Bernie and I read his book together, his presentation of the human soul does not include the definition that the soul is indestructible, but he does argue for it being an immaterial faculty of every human being. And his argument is this, that the soul and the whole of every human being is dependent upon God, who upholds and controls all things. Plantinga suggests that the human soul in Christian thought is personhood. Bernie wants a definition, and he claims there is none among the Christian community for it. But I think most of us Christians would agree with Plantinga that soul is a synonym for personhood. It is popular among contemporary secular humanists to believe that the human soul is merely a part of the neurological hardware of the body. And I would say that it is, more precise for a secular humanist to say that the soul would be a projection of the neurological system. But I personally agree with Plantinga that the human soul is personality, is personhood, something more than a projection of the neurological system. And so materiality does not define existence. Immaterial faculties of the human being actually have existence. If this were not true, then all of my words and Bernie's and any of your words tonight would not exist for a moment. My lips, my teeth, tongue, vocal cords, and brain are not the same thing as the words they form. And the words have an existence and meaning all to themselves apart from the apparatus. And they truly exist, though immaterial. Our Jewish friends in this form know that the Torah has in it, many times over, the Hebrew word nefesh, standing for the human soul. The Jewish scholars who translated the Torah into the Greek Septuagint used the Greek word psyche to translate the Hebrew word nefesh. Not in one instance did they use the Greek word bios to translate nefesh. And so it is accurate to say that for millennia to the present day, Jewish traditions have largely maintained the distinction between body and soul. Plato's philosophy emphasized reality in the immaterial realm of the ideal. His successor, Aristotle, emphasized reality in the material realm. But he did not abandon the duality of body and soul comprising the human being. While Plato argued that the human soul could exist separately from the human body, Aristotle wrote, "The soul does not exist without a body, and yet it is not itself a kind of body. For it is not a body, but something which belongs to a body, and for this reason exists in a body." Plantinga says, "If I were a material object, I would have to be my brain, but it's perfectly conceivable that I exist apart from my brain. It is possible that I exist when my body does not exist. I am not the same thing as my body. I am more than my body." A person who believes that she has been mistreated might say to us, "You are mistreating me like a piece of raw flesh. I am more than that. I am a person." The Christian gospel is this: Jesus has redeemed and restored us, body and soul. God loves and values us, not just our bodies, but everything immaterial about us. No one says she has a beautiful brain, but what we do say is she has a beautiful mind. In closing, consider human memory. Human memory is another facet of the unity of identity argument that supports the existence of supernatural soul, heart, and mind. Arthur Kustance, the Canadian anthropologist, writes, "What research has shown us thus far is that there is no precise one-to-one relationship between any fragment of memory and the nerve cells in which it is supposed to be encoded." Thank you very much.
Thank you, gentlemen. Okay, we'll continue in the same order. It's my turn now to ask a couple questions of each, and then they will ask each other questions. I want to try to keep this even, so I'll try to just pick a couple. Lots of things come to mind. Bernie, you talked about one of the evidences against the soul is that we see the same sort of progression of minds in animals. You spoke about that it appears that animals have minds like people do, and the main difference is that it's quantitative, not qualitative. We're just further down the evolutionary line. Did I get that right? Okay. So it would seem, if that's the implication, that animals will eventually catch up to us if we give them enough time.
We are animals. We are animals. We evolved.
And they will evolve to the same points if given time. Mm-hmm. Would you say that you mentioned that we see in animals the same things we see in human, but on a lesser degree? Did I interpret that right?
Correct.
Okay. So if that's true, what have we seen from animals done by way of literature?
They don't have the... Okay, for literature. So literature would be writing and creativity. I guess they don't obviously write. They don't have a complex speech, verbal system that we do either, but they do have actually communication. There's been studies of... I can't remember what they, some kind of monkey, I think, where they gave a certain call if there's a predator in the air and a different call if there's a snake on the ground. And so when they give this call, the other ones will look up or they'll look down depending on where they're at. And sometimes they even lie. They'll call so everybody goes, runs and hide, and then they'll take this little treat they have and hide it someplace so the other ones can't see it. So they show devious thinking also.
They do show communication, but they don't seem to be able to create letters and alphabets
right.
and literature.
Right, they don't have the complexity.
But you would expect one day raccoons to be writing good literary books.
No, see, raccoons are... See, we evolved from other animals, so our closest cousins would be like the chimps, for example. But chimps don't give birth to a human, so... You know, like Richard Dawkins in his book here, he talks about... If you could take your grandpa and their grandpa and their grandpa and keep on going... down. I mean, he has a picture of this, one of our earliest ancestors, and it's a picture of a fish. This is where we came from.
Okay, so the point is the animals will evolve to where they will be literary at some point.
Well, the animals, there has been a certain evolution, and here we are. This is the snapshot in time that we're at right now. We are animals. And
see,
the chimps are our cousins, the fish are our cousins, everybody's related.
Okay. What about then, if they're going to... eventually, if they're doing everything we do on a lesser degree, what sort of, this is more in your area, maybe the humanities aren't, but what have they invented, innovated, created by way of new technologies or new tools to master their environment?
Yeah, they've studied, like, even birds can create tools. They had this one crow that could bend this thing to get a seed out of this certain area. He couldn't get it out unless he took this wire thing and bent it. So there's lots of examples of animals doing thinking things like that. Now, it wasn't too long ago where theologians and philosophers thought that animals were pretty much like machines. They didn't really even have feelings. And so with all these studies we've been doing, we've been finding out exactly they are quite a bit smarter than we thought.
How would an animal have, how we know that they have feelings? That seems to go a bit against a naturalistic philosophy. What are feelings and how do animals have them?
Well, I guess some obvious things would be like when they're in pain, when one animal kills another one and they're shrieking in pain, mm-hmm. it's like a murder okay. scene, you know?
Okay, you're thinking pain registry, mm-hmm. not so much sad, happy.
Pain is a big feeling, yeah.
Okay.
And they okay. seem to show nurturing love. You can see the mother, even cats purring.
Yeah. I do see some of those. It's hard to imagine the creative sort of aspect. It seems like there's a qualitative difference. But well done. We'll keep going. I have one more question. Okay. I do want to just hit this a little bit more because I think it's a very interesting point Plathinga makes about being hardwired to make. We're not hardwired according to evolution to make sense of the world. We're hardwired to survive in the world. So how can we trust our evolutionary theories that are actually do they make sense of the world? It's an interesting argument. And you stated in there that your evidence was in the area of weapons, and you concluded that by saying you stated that one who relies on God will exit the gene pool. Mm-hmm. Judging from history, looking from Persia to Greece to Rome to more modern Germany, the most powerful and sophisticated military empires have all fallen while Christianity has grown incredibly. Stats show they've grown from early church, 360 non-believers to every believer. I don't know how accurate those are, but I think they're ballpark accurate. It's certainly true that 5, 6, 7 non-believers to every believer in the world today, the ratio has grown incredibly. How do you reconcile this historical evidence with your assertion that only the military strong survive and faith in God leads to extinction?
Well, none of those military, the military greats, none of them are relying on prayer, I think, for a military advantage. I mean, for example, if you go to war against some country that believes in voodoo, for example, they're going to say, well, we're going to have voodoo dolls of the make them of the enemy. Well, that's not going to be effective. It doesn't work. So if some group says, okay, well, we don't need planes and tanks. We're going to fight you with the power of God. They're going to be knocked out. So when you look at through the history, you're seeing the people with the most technology win. They believe in God. They believe in God too. That's true, but they don't rely on God.
Well, the Christian church doesn't take up arms, and it has, and we've known that's been a black eye on Christianity, but in general, the separation of church and state even, that's grown stronger over the past 5 centuries, hasn't slowed down the growth of Christianity. So do you see what I'm saying? There's a disconnect here. The powerful, it is kind of odd that people who held all the chips militarily throughout history, for some reason or other, they die off. And Christianity, which is this really this weak group of people, like in China, that they're so weak, they have no strength, they're persecuted, they're limited in what they can do, and they just keep growing. Doesn't that seem odd historically that Christianity, the truth, one of the early church people said, well, I won't go anymore. I've said enough as a moderator.
Well, I would just say they're like with China. I think they're a big hindrance is communism versus capitalism. I think that's the huge difference. I don't think it has to do with the religion so much.
But do you find it odd that Christians have... who rely on God haven't become extinct, but they've actually grown?
Well, I wasn't talking about Christians in war. I'm talking about governments in war. And if there's a government in war who says, oh, we believe in the power of God, and so let's get the best weapon. What's that going to be? Prayer. They don't do that. They try to develop the best tank. It's going to be nuclear bombs. It's going to be space age technology. Mm-hmm. If there's ever a new invention, that's one of the first things they try to do is weaponize it. That's because evolution's all about arms race.
Okay. Okay, I think our 5 minutes is up. I'll turn my attention to my fellow friend and pastor, Nathan. Nathan, I have more questions about defining terminology. There were a few times I couldn't follow what was meant by certain things, and sometimes I wasn't sure I could reconcile what I thought the word meant. Psychology, you mentioned, I think you said it recognizes immaterial and the existence of faculties such as the spirit, that it... Do you have any evidence of that? I guess my thought is, if psychology is a science, science deals in the observable material world, it struck me as surprising that you mentioned that psychology gives credit to a spirit. Could you explain that more?
Sure. The field of psychology, I think, most of us recognize now as a viable field of science. I'm sorry, Robert wants me to use this. I think it's safe to say that most of us today in the 21st century recognize the field of psychology to be a credible science. And it does integrate with the other sciences. Biological science deals with the body. Mm-hmm. Not completely. There are biological scientists who study the mind as well, because these scientists are integrated. Psychologists major on the mind, on the emotions, on the immaterial faculties, on the personality, the personhood. It does not mean that psychologists bury their heads in the sand when it comes to biological structures of the human being. But the purpose of the psychologist is to work on our mind. That's what I meant. The words, unless you're a reductionist, all of these words for immaterial faculties in the literature, whether ancient or postmodern, all of it's interchangeable. Like if you're a New Testament scholar, you know that soul and spirit are interchangeable terms. You know that if you're a Hebrew scholar, that anything that talks about the breath of life is interchangeable. I can give more clarification if you need it, Keith, but while you and Bernie were talking, I realized that I need to clarify something.
Yeah.
If we're clarifying terms. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that you and Bernie must be dog people when you were talking about animals, because my family's a cat family. Our cat does writes quite well. Beautiful poetry. And our cat, am I not right, Gretchen? And our cat never lies. You guys must be dog people. And then another thing about this gambling, you know, which animals gamble and which do this. See, you're talking about someday dogs will gamble. Well, that's not because, you know, we gamble not because we're on the rise as the human race, because we're on the descent. So you'll know that we have come to the crossroads in evolution when dogs and mankind sit down at the casino table together. And then we will be descending from there as the dogs rise.
There'll be a point.
So that's my belief in evolution.
Well, I think I do disagree on explicitly calling psychology a science, but I think that would be a different debate. So I won't pursue the point. Is the soul really different than the mind? You've used soul, mind, person. You're saying in exchange they're interchangeable. But could you give it doesn't clear up to me very much what the soul is. Could you try to round that out a bit? And in what sense is personhood? And then help me understand soul, mind, personhood.
What I'm doing tonight is I'm answering the question: can modern science disprove the existence of the human soul? My argument is that modern science cannot disprove the existence of any immaterial aspect of humanity. So I chose faculties that I thought everyone in the room most likely would agree exists, like the mind, like personality. So then my line of argument is, if you agree that the mind exists, and you have read sufficiently in the sciences to know that the brain, the little gray cells, and the mind are not one and the same, which is, this is widely held in science. And so if you agree on that, then you are hard-pressed to argue that something like the soul does not exist. Now, you want me to define the soul, and I agree with Alvin Plantinga that it is personhood. And you say, well, what is personhood? Mm-hmm. And I would say the soul is everything that comprises a human being that is immaterial, that is working with the body, but it is distinct from the body. Mm-hmm. That comprises, there is something about the human being that is not flesh and blood, wires, nerves, whatever, what have you. There's something more to the human being than this.
Okay. I have another one, but I think I'd better turn this over to the audience, because we're a few minutes behind. I may have usurped a few. So,
oh,
we do. We,
yeah,
we
Bernie are, and I want to talk to each other again tonight.
You guys need to talk to each other. Sorry, I skipped one. You sure?
There, now I can see you. Hi, Bernie.
I like seeing.
Okay, do you want me to go first?
Yeah, you go first.
Okay, so we got 5 minutes each then?
Yeah.
Okay, first off, your statement is there are a few scientists of any field who are willing to reduce the human being to a mere physiological faculty referred to as the body. I think that's exactly the opposite of the truth when it comes to neuroscience. I think almost all the neuroscientists they're not thinking of any kind of... it is just a machine. Do you disagree with that?
Oh, yeah, I wholeheartedly disagree with that. I think you would be hard-pressed to read widely in neuroscience and have any scientific conclusions written that man is machine. I think most neuroscientists in this present day agree that there is a mind that is distinct from the little gray cells.
Okay, well, let me back up a little bit. I agree with you that the mind is immaterial. Does that surprise you?
No.
Okay, so that's not really a point of contention. And I believe the mind, we have a notion of self and personality. And you mentioned the word reductionism with me, and that's not really maybe very accurate. A better word that is really descriptive is emergence. And to tell you what that means, it's kind of like, for example, H2O, water is H2O, hydrogen and oxygen. And some people can say, well, you know, it's all reduced to hydrogen and oxygen. So for example, could you model in a computer an ocean just with hydrogen and oxygen, make a model of the ocean? I would say, no, you can't do that because it combines and it creates new elements like this liquid state, and the liquids do different things. So there's these emergent properties that bubble up when you combine things, and that's the way the mind is. There's a lot of emergent properties. So I'm not a reductionist in the sense that, you know, if you can just understand where every electron is, you can calculate what people are thinking. I'm not that kind of reductionist. So basically, it's an emergence thing. So I just want to make that clear. So you think dogs have souls too, then?
Now that's debatable. In
cats, yes.
Cats do. But he asked about dogs, and. That's something that's debated in Christendom. There's a lot of different but I'm actually one who believes that all animals have souls.
So then all
and I agree with you that we're animals.
So
Bernie.
Okay, so all animals have a personality then? Because you said a soul means a personality and it's immaterial.
Yeah, to a certain degree.
So worms have personalities and ants have personalities.
I don't know if worms have the breath of life in them. I don't know if nephesh. I don't think they're.
They breathe.
Do they?
Mm-hmm. If you take away the oxygen, they'll die.
Yeah.
So do you think the ants and worms and things are going to have an afterlife then, and the cats and all that?
I don't know. I personally expect there to be a full array of animals. Of animal life in the next life to come in heaven.
Do you think the Earth is around 4 billion years old?
I don't know how old the Earth is. It's a lot older than the literal additions that people do with the biblical genealogies, but I don't know how much older it is.
Well, some people say like 99% of all species that ever lived are now extinct. I mean, so you can think of all the dinosaurs that lived for hundreds of millions of years, and so all these animals are probably have some kind of afterlife. Including all the ants and bats and everything that lived throughout time.
So you're not a hunter?
Yeah. No.
Okay. Well, I don't know how many animals will be in the new heavens and the new earth. And I don't know what the space boundaries are for the new heavens and the new earth. I don't know if you're saying, is there going to be room for all these things?
Well, it's kind of strange, too, that humans, so I think according to your view, if you believe in Jesus and saved, you'll go to heaven. Otherwise, if you refuse Jesus like I do, you'll probably go to hell. But then the cats and all those things are probably going to heaven then?
Well, I mean, you're talking about two different, you're talking about, what you're doing is you're just equating everyone's line from this life to the next. Mm-hmm. And I just, that's complicated. I think it's quite possible that in the new heavens and the new earth, there's going to be animal life and plant life.
So if you're to die right now, do you think your soul stops, or does your soul go to be with God?
Well, yeah, I believe the Apostle Paul when he says that upon our death, those of us who belong to God, our souls immediately pass into his eternal presence.
See, my understanding is that most of the evangelical scholars now, they're starting, because of this idea of emergence and because of neurology, what they've been discovering when they map the brain, I think they're starting to say that the soul emerges with the brain, and that's why I'm saying it's superfluous. And now, so some of them are saying, well, maybe when you die, your soul dies too, and then maybe God will just resurrect it all together. So
well, that's certainly not the New Testament teaching that I adhere to. The New Testament teaching is that upon my death, my soul immediately passes into the heavenly presence of God while my body rots in the grave.
Where did your soul come from?
I just want to know if it is 5 minutes. It's 5 minutes right now, so pretty soon we need to make
it. Okay, from, just one last question.
Bernie, from God.
So, like, I mean, when you were first conceived, was there like a full-blown you that came in to this embryo? Or is your soul something that developed from something very small?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know of anything in the scripture that tells me about the details of soul development. There are other Christian and Christian cult developments to that kind of detail, like the Church of the Latter-day Saints can give you detailed extra-biblical presentations of this, but I try to stick closely to what the Bible tells me, and there's a lot of unanswered questions, like, is there something before the soul?
Well, the other thing I've wondered too is, like, where does the soul come from? If God gave it to you, is it a part of God, or is it something he just created out of nothing, or, you know, what? You know, it doesn't seem to make sense to me either.
Well, right. The God of the Bible is one who can create and does create out of nothing, and is also the one who manipulates, who stoops to the earth he's created and picks up the dirt and forms the human being. So, yes, God the Creator, as the Bible presents this God, my God, creates out of nothing by the power of his word, and also creates out of the substances he's already created.
Okay. Like, there's always just more and more questions. I mean, like, if he's always creating, I mean, some theologians think God's done creating, but if he's always making spirits, he's not done creating. So there's, I don't know. I'll pass now.
Oh, it's my turn to ask Bernie a few questions. Yeah. See, so you're using the term emerging, and I was picking that up with a more scientific term, which is projection. And the reason I think it's more scientific, emerging is a sociological term. And by the way, Keith, I also think that sociology is a credible science.
I agree.
But emergence is a sociological term. Projection is more of a physics term, just by the lexical meaning of those words. So I was using the term projection for it. And so I am curious to know whether or not you believe that there is, if you think that what we Christians call soul is truly simply neurological stuff, the neurological system, or if you think that it is in what you tried to say with the word emergence, if you think it is what I'm saying is a projection of it.
No, well, emergence is actually a very big word now, even in theology, because of this neuroscience, emergence and the soul are going hand in hand, and emergence is a huge term also in biology. So emergence basically talks about over time how you go from something simple to complex, and then all these emergence systems. So basically you have A, and you put A and B together, like a reductionist might think, and you create something that's called C, and you can put these other things together and create D, and then C and D combine and create an E, and then this other thing combines. So you have all these intermediates combining to have this final thing that we have consciousness. So that's why consciousness is very difficult for neuroscience to study. Like you mentioned, their difficulty right now. They don't exactly know how memories are stored. I think one term is brain traces. You know, that's why if you practice things, you make these brain traces, you refresh them. So they're really complicated, exactly where things are stored. Sometimes it looks like they're stored distributively. And also, it seems like there's not one place that's the you in the brain. There's different parts of you that are involved when you do different things. Like when you're really engrossed in something, a part of your brain's working. When you're reflective, when you're reflecting on something, that's a different part of your brain.
Right, but Bernie, when we make these in science, when we make these diagrams, and each part of the diagram is labeled with another letter, each one of those letters represents some kind of material stuff.
No, not necessarily.
Okay. So then I'm waiting for you to answer my question. If you think that the soul or some other immaterial aspect of the human being is merely a projection of the stuff, or is it distinct from the stuff?
Well, yeah, the soul, the way you're talking, yeah, I would say this, it's an illusion that there's some kind of it's a very interesting topic. What am I? Who am I? For example, you mentioned Siri. I mean, it seems to me it's very obvious if you think 100 years from now, there could be robots that very easily talk to each other. And you could even say, what are you thinking or what did you invent? It's not hard to make robots with artificial intelligence that will actually create other robots and things. And if you talk to this robot, you would swear that they were a person. And I think there will be another kind of a consciousness that will arise. It's a machine consciousness, different than ours, because ours is biology-based. But, you know, you would swear this person, I mean, this robot is a person. Just like you look at your dog and say the dog's a person. You know, it's...
So you agree that there could be something that's projected. Like you just said that our consciousness is biology-based. What do you mean by that, that it's biology-based?
Well, I think our consciousness is very unique to the brain and the chemicals and the way they work and everything. A computer, if you had a robot here, it would also have sensors, and it would even have different kinds of sensors and be aware of different things, and it could let you know about what's going on. But I don't think it'd be possible to probably download our consciousness into that consciousness because we have a brain-based biological thing, and it's working. It's a different kind of structure. So it'll be a different kind of consciousness, I think. But, you know, what is consciousness? If consciousness is being aware of your surroundings, making decisions, creating new things, these are things that robots can do, I think, or will be able to do.
Right. And so is it possible that we are actually complex robots, the invention and production of something that has gone before us?
Yeah, I mean, it's actually interesting. If you look at robots, where they at and how they evolved, you know, some of the robots, they can barely walk. Some of them can wiggle. Some of them can swim. And look at the creatures. Wow, that's the way snakes are. They can barely walk, or they swim, and they do all these things, and they just get more and more complex. They have the Google car that can drive itself, apparently, without getting in an accident. So it's like, what kind of an awareness is that? So, I mean, you know, it's still early in the evolution of computers.
Right, but our evolution has taken so long that you do conceive that it's possible that there was something before us that made us, that got us started.
Well, like I said, I think I see, if you look at the different brains across species, you can see the gradual development. You know, chimps are closest cousin, and they can think and show affection and things, but they're not as complex as us. Dogs know how to hunt in packs, so they can. There's killer whales that could work as a team that do hunting.
Yeah. Okay. It just seems to me that there's just little difference between your thinking that there might be a maker for us and that we're complex robots and the Christian saying we've been created by something other than ourselves, and here we are in our complexities today, and we might be able to do the same thing given enough time.
Well, yeah, the maker thing is like what kind of a God would choose evolution, and that's a different topic. So
yeah,
we can talk about that.
That is another topic.
Thank you, gentlemen. There are now mics throughout the area here. If you can approach, if you have a question, go ahead, you can make your way to the mics, and I will try to be as fair as I can in spotting the person. Oh.
It's
spotting the person who's first up. So, and I've got a mic up here. If you're up close, you can use this one. Okay.
Okay. I have a question. Isn't even right to posit that science can prove or disprove something that's supernatural? Science, by its nature, is designed to examine, to replicate natural processes, to evaluate whether they work or do not work, or whether they true or not true. And yet, supernatural is beyond science. It's just like we can only prove so many things using science. How do you verify an historical event? We can't use science to establish that. We have to use other means to establish and verify as much as we can a historical event. So can science really ever disprove or prove the existence of a supernatural soul, especially if we say it's supernatural and it's going to continue on after our physical bodies die?
That's a question I assume for Bernie or for both?
Either one, I'll go with Bernie.
Okay, and so I forgot to tell you that. Please do tell the person that you're addressing the question to that it's for them.
Yeah, that's a good question. What's interesting is when a religious claim makes something that can bear on reality. So, for example, you know, there could be an earthquake, and you could say God caused that earthquake. But with science, we know it was not God's decision to do that. It's plate tectonics. So we know for sure about that. So somebody could have a theology, hey, it was supernatural. I don't think so. The same with lightning. Maybe God caused lightning and thunder, and then we find out, no, it's just electrical differences. So over time, science learns more and more. So if you're going to say that there's a supernatural soul, this is where it's a challenge. You should try to define what it is. And then with science, as it progresses, like in neuroscience, they'll find out more about it. So for example, you know, at one time they could say, well, science, I mean, with the soul is our creative part. That's why we're creative. Animals are not creative. And then they do studies on animals. Oh, wow, animals are creative. Well, we love, we have relationships. Oh, okay, well, then they discover animals do too. And then there's, well, how about self-awareness? Then they do experiments with animals. Okay, there's self-awareness. So the more you make a claim, well, what is exactly this soul? And Pastor Nathan brought up personhood. So that could be another interesting thing. So, you know, usually when there's a supernatural claim, it's trying to be specific enough to mean something. And then science is kind of interesting where it may have something to say about that. For example, you know, you could say too, like Noah's Ark, you know, there was a worldwide flood, but now science comes in there and says, no, sorry, there was no worldwide flood. And that's a historical thing too, by the way. There's certain things you can find through history by deduction and looking at the facts and putting things together.
Yeah, I'll just stand up here. I'll leave this in the front for whoever needs it, if someone needs it. You're up, John.
Please tell me if this is qualifying as off topic. I think this is a question for Mr. Dehler, but I'm not sure. Let me ask the question and then decide. I'm not sure if this is sufficiently related to what we're talking about, but it's come up several times. You talked about whether, as Bernie's been talking about, how some robots can swim and some can barely walk and some can walk. If that can be a similar process to the creative process that God used in creating mankind, how there are different sorts of animals and different ones have certain kinds of capabilities. Could God have been one great creator creating multiple different kinds of creatures? So we talked about going way back and looking at, you know, can we find our creation from the creation of robots? And then we just talked about going way back to creation once again with the soul here. And so we've been talking about, and then we talked about earthquakes and tectonic plates, and God didn't cause the earthquake, the tectonic plates did. But there's sort of the argument that Aquinas made, I think it was, that something made the tectonic plates move, and then something made that happen, and something made that happen, and something made that happen. It's sort of an argument of infinite causes. A ball rolls and causes other balls to roll, but ultimately there had to be someone to push the first ball. Do you consider that to be a valid argument for God? And if not, why not? Is that sufficiently related?
Yeah, and I even said, I was kind of squeamish because I'd like you to stay around the topic, but I said you're free, and so I will not invalidate a question.
Oh,
I
no,
think,
I
think you're really on, at least you're really driving at things that have already been brought up, so it's a fine question. So are you want to direct it to both and or one?
I'm going to direct it to Bernie, and then if Pastor Lewis has something that he just desperately needs to say about cats or something, you know, he's free to do so.
I'd like to emphasize how with science, it's all about evolution, and evolution is more than biological evolution. There's also cosmological evolution, and then after biological evolution, too, there's mimetic evolution, which has to do with thoughts and ideas and societies, how they evolve. So before biological evolution, there's also cosmological evolution. This explains where the planets came from and all that. And then personally, I believe that the Big Bang, I believe in what is called the multiverse theory, which is supposed to be based in string theory, which is still disputed, or not disputed, but not yet demonstrated. But you know, when you look back over the course of civilization, humans thought we lived on a solid earth. The earth has a firm foundation. Who can shake it, as the Bible says? Well, we know the earth is actually spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, going about 68,000 miles through space. It's not a firm foundation. So, you know, the earth is not the center. Then we thought maybe the sun is the center. No, the sun's not the center either. Well, we found out that we've got a few hundred billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy. How many galaxies are there? Well, they think there's a few hundred billion galaxies. So you go from, when you see the trajectory here, one special earth, there's maybe a few planets. Oh, now there's a galaxy, and now there's a few galaxies. Now there's billions of galaxies and billions of stars in each one. It makes it very logical, like, well, geez, why do you think you live in a universe? It's the same kind of, you know, one universe. Wow, we used to think we lived in one universe, you know? So I think it continues along that trajectory. So there's no need for this prime mover. I believe in the turtles all the way down theory that the start is way beyond us. And I don't think there's a start. I think it's just been going on forever. So.
Okay.
The Christian preacher who says, too, that, well, God's the start of everything. Well, then who made God? Oh, I don't have to answer that because God's spiritual. Well, that's an easy way out, too.
Okay. Do you have anything you want to say about that, Pastor?
Yeah, 4 years ago, my daughter Hannah and I attended the Linus Pauling lectures downtown at the Schnitz, and they were really quite eye-opening and stirring. And all of the speakers, as far as I could tell, were not Christians. They were scientists, well-known, and passionately evolutionist, and the cosmologist that spoke in the series talked about the turtles all the way down. And what struck me is that all of these scientists were able to use figurative language, to use examples to help us understand fairly high-level scientific principles and research that they were doing. And it strikes me odd that those of us who are on the street, we tend to be in a uneducated way ultra literalists. Like when the Bible says that the earth has a sure foundation, it means that it's going to survive, and we all know that. But not only the ancients needed an example of a house on a foundation that they understood, like the temple in the middle of their city, but we, postmodern and modern people, we need that too. And so all these scientists were helping me, the bonehead preacher when it comes to science, understand what their work was by giving me day-to-day concrete things, like this, what we're talking about is turtles all the way down, or an unshakable foundation, when they were talking about something that isn't made out of bricks and mortar. So I would just encourage all of us to be a little bit freed up from what we think might be stupid about someone else's literature. Because if we codified and published everything that I heard in the Linus Pauling series and put it there, it would not literarily look any more literalistic or figurativistic than the Bible. So that's what I would encourage us to think on these kinds of terms. It was at the Linus Pauling lectures that I heard that the cosmologists believed it was turtles all the way down. It was there, not in the Bible.
Oh, I'm sorry, Bill, over here.
Yeah, I'm troubled by what I'll call the fuzziness and the expansion of this topic. Can modern science disprove the idea of a soul? And it seems to me any rational person would say no, it can't. And the reason is science is narrowly defined as a methodology that you propose a hypothesis, you propose an experiment, and that experiment produces data of which you interpret, and that experiment can be repeated. And again, that method has been used on up and down some, I would call myself a hard scientist, and we would say psychology is soft. And the reason we say it's soft is because they use the mathematics, they use the method, but the conclusion is soft in its repeatability. We say, well, we finally use statistics and say, well, most marriages dissolve because of financial problems or intimacy problems. But we don't say, you know, we found where DNA expresses a protein, and we can go to this data and build up the hard biochemical analysis. So what am I missing when I say the answer to your question is clearly no? And I was over at Keith's house a couple weeks ago and I read Alistair McGrath's rebuttal of Dawkins, and he said, it's agreed by all these people debating the pros and cons that science and the existence of God are in a different realm, because the burden's on you in this question to say, you made a hypothesis, what's the experiment you proposed, and what's the data from the experiment that now disproves a soul? Mm-hmm. And so I find myself troubled by this kind of moving out into a thousand other areas when, in fact is, Bernie's right. Christians in an earlier history attributed a lot more to God that we can now attribute to science. That, I think we would all, I would admit to that. And at the same time, I don't find that you begin to connect those dots and come up with your experiment to disprove the soul.
I guess I would have two comments. One comment is, you mentioned McGrath and about science can't prove or disprove God. I think that's relating to God as a philosopher's God, maybe. It's a different question if you talk about Jesus or Yahweh or Thor or any other God. You know, so it's kind of an interesting question, more specifically, which God. Back to science, so I appreciate your feedback on this, because this is something I wanted to develop more cleanly. Now, I think the biggest problem here is that soul is not really defined very clearly. So how can we say something's proven or disproven if we don't really have a firm grasp on it? So now most people think, I think traditionally in theology, it's like, well, souls are something that people have, and this is why people go to heaven or hell, and animals don't really have souls. And this is why it's confusing to me to say, like, oh, animals have souls, but what's it going to be like in heaven? It's like, well, you know, worms in heaven and ants in heaven, it doesn't make sense. So what kind of soul are you talking about? Because religions define soul differently. So I guess that's one thing that should be narrowed down as to which Christian denomination are we talking about and what's specific.
I'm not the person who wrote the slide. The burden of proof right. is on you to propose the experiment and interpret the data that says science disproved the soul.
Yeah, so basically, I guess what I'm trying to say by soul is we have obviously, I think we might agree that we have a mind that emerges from the brain. And but some people may say, like, no, that's not a mind, that's a soul. So I'm trying to say, look, scientifically, when you look at nature, you can see the gradations. You can see that animals have what we have. We just have more complexity of it. So why would you think we have something that's special that's going to live on where the animals don't? And the early theologians used to say, well, animals are different. They're not, you know, they don't have souls. And so...
Any sense to me, Bernie, that when you wrote the slide, you must have said to yourself, science and the soul are on some equal term, and I can propose a hypothesis that science says there is no soul, and I can propose an experiment and start collecting the data that's repeatable that will prove that. I mean, you must have thought that. And as soon as I ask the question, it seems like we go out and about.
I guess I'm just saying in neuroscience, when they've been doing the brain mapping, this is probably 10, 20 years, this is all recent evidence. I'm thinking all this recent evidence when they're mapping things to the brain to see how we think, this is all new knowledge. And I think the academics in evangelical Christianity are now moving to the statement of saying the soul is emergent, which is a new thing because of neuroscience. And that's why I'm saying, hey, if you're going to say that, why even have a soul? Because it's the same thing as a mind. So... But I take your feedback. I will clarify. I'll try to clarify it next time. I understand what you're saying.
Let me just express one other thought. The two discoverers of the DNA double helix, Francis Crick and James Watson, very brilliant men. And what they found is that the DNA molecule expresses proteins, and the DNA molecule needs proteins to be for the unzipping process of the DNA molecule. And Francis Crick, as a brilliant man, but a naturalist, had to have, what's the solution to this? And Francis Crick's final solution was, because he saw so much order and design in the expression of proteins out of the DNA molecule, said there had to be a designer here. And since my philosophy has no room for God, it had to be extraterrestrials. Mm-hmm. They came to Earth and designed this protein expression process. To me, that's what this kind of reminds me of. We come with a worldview, and it only has a certain, since Francis Crick was looking for a natural explanation of where all this order came from, he concluded with no data that extraterrestrials designed this.
Yeah, that's interesting, because that's a totally different subject about the origination of DNA, too, which is another whole topic. It's a big gap in knowledge right now about exactly how did DNA originate. It's also interesting, I don't know if you know, but Francis Crick is also now a researcher in neuroscience, well, basically studying consciousness. I don't know if you know that or not. He wrote a book on it, too. So it's interesting that he's in this leading edge field trying to discover consciousness.
Yep, okay. Richard?
I'm trying to get unconfused a bit. The argument I expected here, and I think that you started with, is this is Bernie, but I think my question is actually for Nathan. I kind of want to know from Bernie whether this is right. The law of science, a very big deal on parsimony. You don't postulate entities that aren't needed to explain the phenomena. And so you start with that, and basically your position is you don't need the soul to explain the phenomena. And the worldview, the evolutionary worldview, is just simply, not just simply, but it is committed to continuity, not radical difference. It's committed to degrees of difference piled upon degrees of difference and so forth, and no radical discontinuity. Now, I'm not sure I know what emergence is, but I think I've heard it in the air and round and about and so forth. And it seems to me that emergence might be a secular way to account for radical newness, because you have a little bit of difference, and they synergistically come together at some time, and they create, you know, something that is really different. And that's an advantage, because it gets you outside of the narrow confinements of survival of the fittest and of individual gene mutation. And so now we've got this tremendous mechanism within evolution that can account for some pretty radical differences in our world and in human existence. Now, you were shaking your head no on that, and so I'm wondering whether I've got that right.
Oh, no, yeah, I would say the emergence thing is wrong there. Emergence is a good rebuttal to what they call nothing buttery. Sometimes when you look at anything, you'll say, oh, that thing is nothing but this, you know, something at the very root of it, they call nothing buttery. But so what happens is we don't want to say we reduce everything down. Like I said, water is H2O. You don't want to say it's nothing but hydrogen and oxygen, because what happens is when you combine hydrogen and oxygen, you get other elements, and then these things combine and they have waves. Well, those waves, you don't have those when you have just hydrogen and oxygen. So you can't model this stuff just from hydrogen and oxygen. You have to, you know, model it through water. And that's just one level of emergence. The people who wrote about this, they say emergence starts at the very bottom with even electrons and how they orbit and all these things. Life is very complex. So it's against this idea of nothing buttery, where you just break something down and say, oh, it's nothing but this.
Well, in linguistics, this kind of idea, evidently not emergence, allows you to account for language, because the evolutionary steps to achieve language is incredible to contemplate. And so
it doesn't seem that difficult, because, I mean, animals already have a communication,
but
more complex.
For a linguist, you know, who are highly invested in their topics, of course, and on the complexity of language, don't find that credible. And so they say, you know, it kind of just happened as a byproduct of something else. Other changes were taking place, and all these mutations were lying around there, and they somehow came together, and they yielded the mechanism that grounds in the brain, not in the spirit, but in the brain that grounds language. Now, my question then for Nathan is, why is the soul concept useful or necessary? Now we have the soul against the mind. We don't know what the mind is, for sure. And there have been materialists that have spoken against the use of the term mind in talking about human beings. But what do you see, perhaps, as the reason why we really need the soul as a concept?
I'll answer with two answers that are important to me. And I think the first one every secular humanist should share with me, and that is the idea and the existence of the human soul allows for a value that we share across all human lines, unless we are in some way perverted and corrupt. And that is, we all value the uniqueness of individual personality and expression. And not that I have to be completely different from you and you from me, but we sense, we observe, and we deeply value that each one of us, though human and though similar, have something unique about us, that we have fingerprints that go beyond our fingerprints. And soul gives to us this. Whatever the soul is this. And I think all human beings, unless they have been corrupted away from this, know the importance of this. That Keith and I are not the same all the way down. He has a few quirks unique to him, and I have a few quirks unique to me, that we're not machines. For the Christian, the soul is altogether important because the scripture speaks of it over and over and over again. And so everything that we say when we try to codify the whole of scriptures comes down to we having souls that will never die, as we teach our children in the catechism. Because there is a connection between us and God, who does not have a body like humanity. And the image of God that Bernie gave the Latin for, Imago Dei, is central to the biblical text and to the Christian faith and practice, that we are made in the image of God. And so there is something about us that allows us to relate to God that my cat does not share in completely, even though my cat, as I said, is literate and is honest. I don't think that my cat is a Christian. She acts like a secular humanist last time. I'm afraid that my cat is secular humanist. And the reason why is that late at night, she leaves my house, and so I followed her. And she's been going over to Bernie's house. And so anyway.
I couldn't see you below all this stuff. Chad, go ahead. Who's your question for? And go ahead.
To Nathan.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
Nathan, do you think that germs have souls and they will go to heaven? Thanks.
Well, I don't know. I've always thought of germs as being part of the common curse. But see, it gets me to mosquitoes too, which are a little bit bigger. And I'm wondering if mosquitoes had a pre-fall positive purpose. I don't know. I hate them. I think they're just now, because I live under the common curse. I live on this side of humanity falling into sin and changing everything. So for me, mosquitoes are bad. Now, I know that germs are good in that we take some of them and we inoculate ourselves so that we build up an immunity. But only in a postmodern world can we call them good. They are by scientific measurement, something that is dangerous and contagious. And so I think they're part of the common curse that we'll be relieved of them. I think that the new heavens and new earth, heaven in God's eternal presence, will be a place free of disease, free of contagion, where everything will be returned back to its original and glorious order, where mosquitoes will come and frolic across the hairs and pores of my arm and never bite me again.
Also got another question.
Yeah.
Do you think, like, when babies die, when they go to heaven, do they, like, still act like a baby, or are they like a complete man?
Yeah, I've thought about that before. Yeah, I don't know about that. I just don't know about the progression. I think that when you get to heaven, I would recognize you, but I think you would be qualitatively different for the better. But I don't know if you would just be static. I don't know if you die at age 7, you'll be 7 forever. I don't know about that. I think that what I can tell you is that heaven, the new heavens and new earth, seem to be a dynamic, sustainable system, a whole array of new ecosystems. So I would imagine there would be progression and dynamic growth.
Well, I have a couple of comments on that too. This brought up two really good points. One is, again, emergence. People, your personality emerged based on where you grew up and your environment. If you grew up in China, you would be a totally different person. Your soul, your personhood, what you are right now is based on how your brain even wired itself by the way it grew up. If you're to die as an infant, your brain's not going to get wired in any kind of way when you're in a spiritual world, because you don't have a spiritual brain anymore. The other thing, too, you mentioned by way that, you know, pre-fall. Well, a lot of the theologians now who are accepting evolution are saying we need to rework theology. There was no fall. There was no state of paradise given evolution. We know there was no human, there was no first humans. And this is a very big point. So all of theology has to be reworked. So when you say pre-fall, you're showing that you haven't yet fully accepted evolution and the ramifications of it.
Right. My theology is only reworked as I study the Holy Scriptures of the Christian Bible and the Hebrew Bible, and I allow that to inform, and I've got a long ways to go. But I will always push the other sciences through that grid of biblical theology. That is how I will continue to integrate the rest of the sciences. I'll push them through the biblical grid.
I don't know who was up first. Okay, over here then. Go ahead.
Okay.
You're being a gentleman to point that way, but I...
Anyway, just one thing, well, two things, but Bernie, it seems
like
you...
Who's your question for first?
What's that?
Is your question for one in particular?
Bernie.
Okay.
Bernie, the first thing is, it seems like you always rely on the Socratic fallacy, and it's an informal fallacy of logic, and that's that if you can't define something, it doesn't exist. I mean, that's sort of a crude statement of it. But, I mean, I satisfactorily have not heard the wave-particle duality defined. I haven't heard, the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle defined. Maybe it's permanently undefinable. But you seem to think there's a necessary connection between the inability of certain communities to define the soul and infer from that, therefore, it doesn't exist.
No, my argument wasn't you can't define the soul, therefore it doesn't exist. I'm just saying that was one of the complications with the earlier question, does science disprove the soul? Well, to talk about the soul, we should try to define it. And there's a lot of different definitions depending on which denomination you're in. So that's probably one of the weaknesses of this whole discussion tonight is probably to do this again, coming up front, we should have a crisp definition for what, you know, the soul is. So I don't agree with you that was a fallacy because that wasn't my point. I'm saying go ahead and define the soul, then let's talk about it. And as far as, would you say wave incoherent? Well,
yeah, I mean, I'm not happy with the definition of the wave particle duality, so could I infer from that it doesn't exist?
Okay, so I think what you're referring to is... the behavior of an electron, and in some cases it looks like a particle and sometimes like a wave. And this doesn't make sense to us because how could something act like a particle and a wave? And because what was the incoherence thing about we're not sure where an electron is until you collapse
it.
So sometimes people say, well, because things are indeterminate, well, therefore, it's kind of like, I think when you think that out, though, it's kind of like going down a different argument. It's about kind of free will and things like that, but... people are kind of tied to the soul, I guess, because it sounds like to do with free will. So
I don't tie it to the soul. But the other question I had, like right now in philosophy, the two dominant theories of consciousness are the identity theory, you know, that consciousness is identical to, you know, the physical properties of our brain. And the second one is functionalism. And it seems like with emergence, you're fudging. You're trying to create almost a sort of mysterious position that allows you to escape from reductionism. For instance, Daniel Dennett, identity theory. He doesn't believe the self exists. He doesn't believe in free will. Individuals that are familiar with reductionist theories of consciousness are ended up with conclusions. It sounds like you're trying to escape. And the thing about emergence is, regardless of how complex the system is, you could still break all those components down into physical properties. I mean, regardless of whether right now we're able to do that, if our knowledge may not be sufficient to do that, but still, you're not arguing those are non-physical properties. You're just arguing that they're combining in a way that's extremely complex. So reductionism is still possible with emergence.
What was that last statement? What was still possible?
Reductionism is still possible with the emergent theory.
Well, yeah, I would say emergence could be a form of reductionism. The reductionism one, though, is just when you say things are nothing but, and like if you just knew at the very bottom, you could model everything. And that's why I'm saying this theory of emergence is that you can't model something based on the very bottom layer of it.
But you could break it all down and eventually reach that bottom layer.
Well, the thing is, when you look at how things are broken down, if you take a machine apart, you can break it all down and find out what it's made out of, but usually it's kind of like the opposite to understand how it's built or how it works. You want to go the opposite way and see how it's built, because this is where you start to see the emergent properties. When you tear something down, you don't really see the emergent properties. You see it when you build it up. But I want to say, too, that I agree with you about consciousness. The science of consciousness is still being understood. I'm just saying what we know about neurology is enough to let us know that there's not some kind of supernatural thing in there to control our mind. I mean, you know, there's so many different cases of, you know, like we used to think, well, when somebody throws a fit, epileptic seizure, maybe the demon was causing that because that was their soul. Their soul was under attack. Well, now we know it's these electrical storms and how they can prevent them with surgery by separating the separate parts of the brain. And when they do those experiments, they find out other things about the brain. All these brain experiments we've been finding, it's just like the idea of the soul dissipates because they used to think was just kind of magical, but now we're starting to see how things are mapping to the brain. I'm not saying it's figured out. I'm saying we have enough indication to know that.
Well, there's a neurocorrelate to phenomenal consciousness. You know, if I cut myself and have a, you know, experience of pain, you could track that down causally from my nerve fibers, but there's still a phenomenal element which philosophy cannot explain and science cannot explain at all, the subjective element of consciousness. They just have no clue.
Right.
Steven Pinker has given up. He said, let's just forget about it. We can't explain it. And I think if you were to follow what you're saying to its conclusions, the result would be determinism. And if determinism is true, then knowledge is out the window, because our knowledge isn't determined by what the truth is, but it's determined by prior causes. And it seems like the emergent people realize the very nasty implications of reductionism, and they're trying to avoid that by sort of a squishy sort of a secular mysticism.
Well, I just want to repeat that. I think it's not a matter of, there's a lot of things we don't know, that's true. Just like in evolution, there's a lot of mechanisms we don't know about how it happened, but we know it did happen by looking at the evidence, especially in DNA. So you can know something happened as a fact without knowing the mechanisms of it. So I'm just saying too, yeah, there's a lot of mysteries in consciousness because it's so complex. We're like as dumb as cavemen on many things still. But it's not a matter of what you don't know. Sometimes it's a matter of what you do know, and you can put things together and take out other competing hypotheses, you know, such as there's a supernatural thing that invades you. I mean, like, somebody says, I'm possessed by an evil spirit. Are you going to believe that? And if you know a lot more about neuroscience, are you going to believe them? The spirits, how come these spirits are reacting to these psychological drugs and things? I mean, some things don't add up.
No, I mean, I understand what you're saying there. I just think, would you be willing to give up the existence of the self?
It's a complex thing. I'm still trying to understand exactly. I mean, from what I understand, there's no part of the brain that is really functioning and overlooking everything. The
right.
Different parts of the brain work at different times. So there is no one chunk that's like the master controller doing everything kind of thing.
Yeah, no, that's Daniel Dennett's position. He doesn't believe that there is a self. He doesn't believe we're conscious. Anyway, I don't want to continue, but the point is that if you really follow your position, I think, to its logical conclusions with Dennett and a lot of other people in the philosophical community have, you would reduce human beings to something that nobody would recognize, that there has to be something beyond just atoms and neurons to account for the experience of human beings in reality.
Well, you just said humans. What about cats? Is that a different thing?
Is it
the same thing?
I think it was interesting you guys brought up the question of language, because the philosopher Wittgenstein, you know, in his private language argument, came up with a brilliant art. Well, it's a complicated thing. We won't get into it. But my challenge to you would be, demonstrate to me how animals got the ability to abstract. Coco. When they taught Coco language, Coco can only communicate with things she can see, smell, feel, and touch. We have the ability to think abstractly. And that's something that I've never seen a legitimate account in any sort of philosophical or scientific position. So I don't think animals, I think animals can give you a little ways of where you want to go, but there's a complexity to human language that far transcends what you guys have talked about tonight.
Okay, boy, that was fascinating. I feel like this is a
Thank you very much for your questions.
Yeah,
that was wonderful. Thank you.
I'm gonna come over here, Julie. What's your question, sweetheart?
Yes, I just have two points. I want to follow up with that point about the complexity of language. Bernie, do you speak another language fluently?
No. Not fluently.
Okay. Well, speaking
except for gibberish.
having the experience, my husband and I do speak another language fluently, even to the point where we dream in Spanish. So we've lived, an entire lifetime being absorbed in another language, and that experience teaches you how absolutely complex language is. We can express humor. We can express anguish. We can express abstract thinking. We can express deep emotion, and that experience of getting into another language is just so impacting that you cannot, I know there's no way animals can replicate even a fraction of that experience of communicating in another language, or communicating the depth of what we can express, the subtleties of language and all of that. But the other point that I wanted to make was that you say that we're only a product of the environment that we've grown up in. As a wife of a twin and a mother of twins, I would have to say that my experience completely has been the opposite. The first day that I held my twin boys in my arms, I knew that they had different personalities. And that has proven itself throughout
I agree with that, though. And I'm just saying, though, something would have happened to you, and those kids were taken away and raised in China, they would be different people than.
But what I'm saying is, they're so different from one another, and they had the same womb experience, they had the same home environment,
right.
Everything exactly the same.
I agree.
And even so, their personalities are so absolutely different that I believe that's the hand of God. That God's made them different, and they approach life differently. They approach problems differently. They have different talents, different interests, and there's something innate in them that is pre-programmed, I believe, by God to make them who they are. And so they're completely different from one another, as any mother of many children could attest.
You know, all cats and dogs are different too. So did God pre-program those different personalities?
The question is, you said it was all nurture. That's what she's asking. Is it all nurture? That's the question.
No, there's a combination, yeah.
Oh, you said it was all nurture in your
talk.
No, not
all
nurture. That's what she's asking.
Not all nurture, no.
That's what you said, so you can clarify.
No, I just said if that kid was raised in China, it would be a totally different kid than the way she raised it. In addition to that, the DNA and everything else is different, and there's a lot of differences, I guess. We probably can't even comprehend all the differences. Okay. I always go back to this idea that we're still dumb as cavemen, even though we think we're scientists. You know, knowledge is exponentially growing, and it's got a long ways to go still.
Okay, it did appear you say that. That's why there was a confusion. But if you're clarifying, you didn't. Okay. John? Oh, wait. You've already asked one, and you're in line. John, go ahead.
I'll defer to the young lady.
You're a gentleman. Bethany and then John.
So what we're issuing here is this basic question of mind and body dualism. We talked about this at my school. And I also have, I'm personally trying to reconcile what I've read in Scientific American Minds, but yet also with my Christian beliefs. I mean, it's a struggle we all go through. I don't want to throw one or the other out the window. I would first like to ask Pastor Nathan where he defines the line between maybe soul problems and mind problems. For example, anorexia, it's chemicals in the brain. Depression, chemicals in the brain. It can heal with medication. Also, I read an article about how when they raise a child and certain neuroconnections are made in your brain, they can correlate. For example, if a child is raised without a father, they are more likely to have these certain problems because they didn't form certain connections in their brain. So where would you define that line between sort of neurological or physical problems and soul? So does the soul cause those problems, or does the mind cause those problems? Like, it's issue of...
Well, I can't draw the line for you.
Well, yeah.
I don't think anyone can draw the line. I think we know that all of the human faculties work together, and the only thing that separates the human faculties is death. So prior to death, all of human faculties work together, and they're inseparable. They're fully integrated. So I don't know about that. I think, once again, you are showing how important it is for us to allow all the sciences, including theology and anthropology and some other ones that I know now not to mention in the room, to allow all the sciences to work together. In past forums, biological science has been assumed to be the only science, to be the queen of sciences, at the expense of philosophy, at the expense of sociology. The question is, which of these sciences is the best one to step out and take the lead to find the line that you're talking about between soul and mind? Should it be theology? Should it be psychology? Should it be medical science? Or do they all need to work together? We actually live in a world where they all work together. And the reason that is happening is because we live in a world that still acknowledges that not everything is natural, not everything is biological that is of value, not everything is material. Because we know this down deep inside, we integrate all the sciences to answer those kinds of questions.
But, you know, kind of related to that too, like Alzheimer's. Sometimes when somebody has Alzheimer's, they say, oh, that's not really the Joe. The real Joe was like when he was 50. Now it's like Alzheimer's is masking that. So he's got like a pure soul somewhere, but his brain is kind of like masking his expression of his soul. But notice how when they're younger, when they're emerging, this is like the dissipation ages, but when they're emerging, when they're a one-year-old, they don't say, oh, that's Joe. He's a mature thinker, but he's still at the toddler stage. He's kind of blocked or something. You know, they don't say that. That's just him. He's just growing up. But for some reason, when they get old and dissipate, they don't want to acknowledge that and say, oh, you know, that's not the real him. It is the real him. We need to appreciate people in every stage of life they're at, I think.
You could technically label that as the soul sort of in its expression through the vehicle of the body being sort of inhibited by certain, you know, decay of the body. Would you? I guess.
See, that's what I'm saying. It's not fair to say, well, the body can decay, the body can hide the soul in the old age, but you don't consider that also for the young age, too. How come the young age you see the emergence, but then instead of seeing the dissipation, you say, oh, well, then it's just masked? It's not consistent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, John? Go ahead.
This question is for Bernie. Bernie, when the gentleman was talking about the perceived inconsistencies in your hypothesis here and talking about Coco and not being able to think about things that weren't or deal with things that weren't visible, couldn't be smelled or touched or what have you, made me think that as a human being and as a Christian, I look at things that are present in my life, my children, my wife, the memory of people that have died a long time ago in my life that were important to me. And those things, those feelings that I have, I believe in the thing that Nathan has talked about, personhood, the personhood that those individuals enjoy, are things that make, and well, let me keep going. Those things, I believe, are God-given. And that's my, those feelings I have for my 12-year-old daughter, or what have you, are God-given, that they're immutable. They're not going to change my love for my daughter, my love for my wife. And I give that credit, if you will, for those things that I have emotion for, what have you, to the existence of a soul given to me by God, breathed into me. My existence is God-given. So that's my hypothesis. If you say that the soul does not exist, then for you, what is love?
Well, I guess one question I had for you is, Coco, is that I can't remember if that's a gorilla or gorilla. I believe Coco also expressed deep love and pain and grief. Isn't that right?
I'm no expert
from
on Coco.
From what I understood. Well, yes. I think some of these animals too, they communicate. They show like they're trying to show one some prospective mates, you know, and even on a TV screen, it's like, yeah, I like this one, not this one, you know, and stuff like that. And Coco Lonely or whatever this animal's name was. So these animals are also showing love, and the people who work with them, they get very attached too, like they're their own children. They love each other.
I don't want to camp out on Coco. I want to make the point here. But 12-year-old daughter, I would take my life and lay it down for my 12-year-old daughter if I had to right this moment without hesitation.
And lots of animals would do the same thing too, right?
Right. But let's get off the animals for a minute. I'm talking about a human emotion, a human realization that I have for my daughter right there, that I would die for her at this moment. And when I'm not with her, if I'm on the other side of the planet, I'm thinking about her. And I call that love, and I call that an expression of the soul that God has given me. And I know that I can see a wedding band, I know you have a spouse. So when you say that you love your wife, if you don't have a soul, what is love to you?
Okay, I'll answer that question too, but I'm just thinking about, you know, you said you call that love and you think there's a spiritual connection there or something too. I'm just thinking, you know, squirrels will give their life for their, too, you know, the birds will do that and everything else too. There's other
animals. And if the squirrel dies, if the mating pair of squirrels, one of them passes away, the next spring that squirrel's mating with somebody else and probably has not had a what we would consider a conscious thought about that dead squirrel in 5 minutes after it perhaps died.
Yeah, so, hard to say. I'm just saying they give their life in the same way. So basically, I mean, the question you're talking about, love, I think it's still probably a mystery they're trying to understand, just like consciousness. There's a lot of mysteries about the brain, how it works and chemicals and, you know, trying to understand it all. There's still a lot of work. So my point would be, what we do know, we can draw some conclusions towards, not pointing to the unknowns and saying, oh, there's some unknowns, therefore let's not make any judgments at all. I'm saying, given what we do know, can we make some judgments? So there's a lot of mysteries I'm saying about love and all that and how that works in the brain. But I don't see how your love is all that different than animals, though. I mean, everything you say you do for the loved ones of the animals also seem to do.
Do you really find that satisfactory, that answer you just gave?
I think it's a fact that animals love their kin just like you do.
But you're a human being, right? Mm-hmm. So as a human being with someone that you're committed to for the rest of your life, I suppose, right? Mm-hmm. You haven't talked about the ability of human beings to commit to one another, to be self-sacrificial in their and permanently willing to put others in front of themselves. That is not something that I believe comes to us through our biological functions as much as it does. I don't have the capacity to do the things or to believe the things. I don't believe that those things have come to me of my own ability to rationalize the universe around me and to think that me laying down my life is not going to further my species, right? Laying down my life for my daughter is going to help her survive. It's going to help her. It would be out of an emotional attachment to somebody.
Yeah, I'm saying, yeah, it's different. Everything's different for humans, and we have more advanced brains. You know, the animals beat us in some things, like, you know, they have bigger teeth and bigger claws, bigger muscles, but we have bigger brains. So, you know, that just makes us a dominant species, and we do things differently. But the things we have aren't unique as far as giving yourself for your loved ones.
We're going to have to, I think we're going to have to call it an evening. We've got small kids here. It is 8:30, and I'm apologetic. John's been waiting for a while. I'm really sorry, John. I think we could give you first dibs on coming up and talking with the speakers afterwards, but I think we do need to give a freedom. And then everyone is free to stay around. I'll stay around and close the building up late. You can continue the discussion, but for the families involved, I think we need to go ahead and give them the freedom to walk out. And thank you all for coming tonight.
It's been very enlightening. I want to give a round of applause to Bernie and Nathan for that.